Each one of our honorees will be introduced by a member of our advisory board. I will present to Dr. Fauci. Gary Sheffer will recognize Judy Woodruff. Sandra Clark will present to Gene Robinson. And Charlene Wheelis will honor Bill Hayman. Each honoree will receive the Larry Foster Award for Integrity in Public Communication. Before we get started, I would like to thank our platinum sponsors who, through their support, not only helped make this event possible, but also kept registration fees free. And they include the AARP, Johnson & Johnson, Merck, and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. I want to thank you for your support and for providing hundreds the opportunity to be here tonight. So to begin, I am extremely pleased and very honored to introduce Dr. Anthony Fauci, a man who hardly needs an introduction, having served as advisor to every U.S. president since Ronald Reagan. Over the course of the past year during the pandemic, he has garnered more media time, earning profound public respect, admiration, and deeper trust than anyone since perhaps Walter Cronkite. Dr. Fauci, thank you for being the person you are. Thanks for your dedication and your hard work for many years. We sincerely want to congratulate you for all the well-deserved honors and recognition you have received for your professional experience and accomplishments. But our recognition tonight is different. Fundamental to the respect you have earned is your personal integrity and your commitment to the truth, as well as the imperative you have expressed to, quote, let the science speak, end quote. Although the COVID-19 pandemic continues to cause serious and widespread damage to our people and our economy, you have been a voice of reassurance that we can get through this. You've become a widely trusted source of information, a position that is critically important to journalists and others who attempt to keep the public informed. You are, sir, an icon of integrity in public communication, and we appreciate this opportunity to single you out for this attribute. Many in the field of medicine and healthcare will learn from the example that you have set. This will certainly help in dealing with our need to restore public trust in medical science. We're not alone in our high regard for you. Here are several other voices in tribute to what you have accomplished.
I've known and covered Dr. Fauci for going on four decades. And even though reporters are supposed to be careful not to personally characterize the people we cover, I have no hesitation in saying that Tony Fauci is the most trusted scientist in the country, probably the most trusted person, period.
Dr. Fauci is brilliant. He's courageous. He's inspiring. He is an anchor at a time of rough seas.
Dr. Fauci has been doing this job for 40 years, being the nation's chief infectious disease doctor, handling all sorts of difficult situations. I think with integrity, though, it's one of these things that you don't see. It's how someone behaves when no one else is looking.
He is the embodiment of integrity. He has brought honesty and straight talk throughout this terrible pandemic, when that is what Americans were desperately seeking.
I would have to say that above all, Dr. Fauci is a patriot. He is always doing what he thinks is best for our nation, based on the best science and based on ethical values.
We see him on television. We see him informing the world about these infectious diseases, but what we don't see is the degree of integrity that he brings to his job, helping shepherd the vaccine projects, the therapeutic projects, and all those things that ultimately are going to lead us out of this pandemic.
Congratulations, Dr. Anthony Fauci. Tony, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you very much, Bill. It is with a deep sense of gratitude, excitement, and sincere humility that I accept this prestigious award, particularly receiving it together with other distinguished awardees, Judy Woodruff, Eugene Robinson, and Bill Hayman. I've had the distinct pleasure of practicing my communication skills on one of the awardees, my good friend Judy Woodruff, who has interviewed me many times over the years. My brief comments come to you from the perspective of a scientist, a physician, and a public health official. I have had, over my 54 years since graduating from medical school, the opportunity to communicate with patients as their physicians, with students and residents whom I've trained, with peers who are equal to or better than I in science and with whom I communicate science, with my staff of thousands whom I lead, and with the public whom I serve as a public servant and global health official. It is for the latter that I am receiving this award. However, importantly, lessons pertaining to communication have come from each of these roles, and several principles that apply to public communication share a commonality with each of these roles. And so, what are the core principles that guide me through public communication in my role as a scientist? Although many of these principles do not pertain directly or specifically to integrity, they facilitate your building credibility and maintaining your integrity. First and foremost is to know your audience. I know scientific colleagues and public health colleagues who speak to public audiences like they are speaking to their postdoctoral fellows or to an audience at the National Academy of Sciences. When you speak to the general public, appreciate that you are certainly speaking to a mixed audience. Do not talk down to them, nor over their head. Strike a balance of getting a clear, crisp message across so that almost everyone will get something out of it, some more than others. Which actually brings me to several related principles of communication that particularly relate to science communication. The purpose of communication by a scientist is not to show how smart you are. It is to have people understand what you are talking about. How often have we heard audiences comment after hearing a lecture or a press conference say, "This person must be brilliant, but I did not understand anything he or she said." The next principle I learned from my Jesuit mentors in high school and college: when communicating, remember the tenets of precision of thought and economy of expression. Know precisely what your message is and be brief. Once you get that down, then you can exercise and maintain your integrity. Some important issues. The scientific method produces evidence and data. Often this leads to inconvenient truths. The public needs to hear the truth as it is, rather than as they might want it to be. Sometimes this means saying, "I just do not know." Answer the question that you were asked. Do not exaggerate or minimize. Never guess. If someone truly wants your opinion in the absence of enough data to make a firm statement, make sure that you qualify your statement. Stick with what you know to be the facts and never, ever be intimidated or pressured into agreeing with something that you do not believe is true. Such an approach both builds credibility and maintains integrity. Thank you.
So thank you very much for those words. We had dozens and dozens of online registrants pose questions that they wanted to put to you. You've already answered a couple of them. Jessica Myrick, a professor here at Penn State, asked about your thoughts on the best way to communicate with the public, if they've changed as a result of your experience in the past year. And I think you made it clear that you know, truth is at the core of your response, your responses. And I think consistency of message, too, is important. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. And one of the things about science that you need to explain is that often when you are dealing with an evolving situation, that what changes is evidence. And sometimes you might come to a conclusion based on the evidence that you have at a given time. But as you learn more and more, you have to be humble enough to say, you know, what we said some time ago was based on evidence that we had, but right now the evidence is changing, and explain that is the evidence that drives what your recommendations are. It isn't that you're flip-flopping because you're just changing your mind. As long as you go with the evidence that you have at the time, that really does maintain your credibility.
Let me ask you a couple more of these. Linda Lillian Wonderly, a student at the University of Hartford, asks, what advice do you have for upcoming college students in the communications field? And believe me, we have hundreds and hundreds of them watching tonight, especially those who are preparing for positions in the field of health and healthcare.
Well, I think I mentioned that in some of my principles, but let me just explain that. You know, and it really does have to do with communicating, not just with the public, but communicating. For example, I learned that when I first had to communicate with my patients and giving them news without frightening them, but news that was the truth. So you have to know what I've said, the precision of thought and economy of expression. Know your audience and know what your message is. The field of communication is extraordinary because the influence that you can have on so many people is just striking. And so as a student in communication, I think one of the things that, which is, I guess, the purpose of some of the discussions tonight, is to maintain that credibility and that integrity right from the beginning, from your student years up to whatever exalted or not position that you ultimately will reach.
Okay, I'd like to move away from communications and ask you to put your director hat back on. A number of people asked, what is your sense of our preparedness as a nation for the next possible pandemic, and where do you think that might come from?
Well, one of the things that I've learned over the many years I've been doing this is that these are really, quite frankly, unpredictable. And that's the reason why the type of preparation must be that you must build the infrastructure, the public health structure, the scientific base to be able to move quickly. You know, it is very interesting that prior to the COVID-19 outbreak, the Johns Hopkins University School of Public Health voted the United States, looking at all the different nations, the European Union, as the best prepared for a pandemic outbreak. And yet, if you look at what has happened over the last year, we have suffered the most worst than any other country in the world. A terrible landmark was reached yesterday with 500,000 Americans having died from this outbreak. So it's a combination of being prepared, which are fundamentals, good health infrastructure, good science base, good communication, good transparency, have a global health security network so that you know what's going on in different parts of the world, and have a global agreement that we will be transparent with each other. But then there comes the response, and the response has to be a unified response based on good fundamental principles. And as we've learned through painful experience now, a divisive nation does not respond very well to something that is uniformly experienced by everyone, namely that these types of infections don't have any borders. So individual components, individual states doing things differently did not serve us very well.
I certainly wish we had more time. In fact, I'd love to get together with after this to talk about communications. But finally, I think we should discuss a little bit this issue of restoring public trust in medical science and your point that we must let the science speak. And how do you think that we're going to restore public trust and confidence in the CDC? And why is that so important? We know that it is.
Well, the CDC is the premier public health organization, you know, in the country and in the world, quite frankly. Other countries use it as a model. It's been a difficult year for them for a number of reasons. We now have a director of the CDC, Dr. Rochelle Walensky, who is a good friend of mine, a physician, a scientist, who is here now. And if you look at the people at the CDC, they are extraordinarily good. If you let the CDC be the CDC, we will be fine. And that, I think, is about as true as you can say. Let them be who they are, which are really fine public servants. Now they're led by a fine leader. We will do well with them over the coming years.
All right, sir. Thank you so much for your time. I know you're running 17-hour days and have been for a long time. We very much appreciate your time. And Tony, I want to say congratulations, Dr. Anthony Fauci, on receiving Larry Foster Award for Integrity in Public Communications. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Bill. I really appreciate it very much. Thank you.
I am truly honored to present the Larry Foster Award for Integrity in Public Communication to Bill Heyman, CEO of Heyman Associates, and someone I am fortunate to call a friend. As you'll hear in a few moments, Bill, like his fellow honorees, is more than deserving of this prestigious award. As I started to prepare this introduction, I thought, I should share all of his personal and business accomplishments, of which there are many. But I decided that I'd rather talk about Bill, the man, the person, the counselor. So I checked in with a few of his friends and colleagues and asked them to describe Bill in one word. I learned two things from this exercise. One, never ask someone, and especially a communicator, for just one word to describe anything. And two, we should all be so fortunate to have some of these same things said about us one day. Bill, here are just a few of the ways your friends and colleagues describe you. Inspiring. Generous in spirit and heart. Hilarious. Wicked smart. Kind. Humble, deeply caring, warm, selfless, just a great human being in a time when we need such people the most. And he is a true gift to the people who are blessed to know him. Before I introduce the video, I'd like to share a personal anecdote. I have known Bill for about 20 years as an executive recruiter and someone I admired, friendly, but not yet a friend. That all changed one afternoon in a bar in New York City. I was drinking, he wasn't, it was still during the workday. We spent an hour or more having a frank conversation about cancer, mine and his. Quite honestly, it was an intimate conversation, and it meant a lot to me. I don't think I've ever told him that. That afternoon, Bill showed me who he is. And it's all of those things I said earlier and more. And after that day, I proudly added the words, a dear friend, to my description of him. As Martin Luther King Jr. said, the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. In this, Bill stands tall. I have long thought that legacies are not based on the things we build, but rather on the lives we touch. Bill, your legacy will be one for the history books. Let's watch the video.
Bill is the definition of loyal to his family, to his friends, to his work colleagues, to candidates and clients alike.
This was a guy who was in it for the long haul, a guy who really valued relationships and who really wanted what was best for you.
Bill is all about relationships. If you know Bill, you also know he's also the master of the follow-up. He does what he says he's going to do.
Bill's success is no accident. He is generous, supportive, and effective as an owner and a leader. But most important are his traits that relate to integrity.
He's a networking machine, not in a self-serving way. He keeps in touch with more people in a month than most people do in a year.
I always thought recruiters had two major constituencies to deal with, clients and talent. But most focus all their energy on clients, and the talent side of it feels very transactional. They only want to deal with you when they need you. Bill was not like that, and that made a big impression on me.
Bill is loyal, a leader, and always about elevating those around him.
This has been true and obviously very evident as a founder of Heyman Associates, as a son, as a husband, as a wonderful father, and a great friend.
Bill is the epitome of integrity, doing the right thing and knowing that nobody's going to know whether you did it or not. So Bill, let's raise a glass to your well-deserved award. Congratulations.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bill Heyman.
Thank you so much, Charlene. And thank you to Bill Nielsen and the Page Center board, many of whom have greatly impacted my career. I also want to thank Marie Harden, Denise Bortree, and Jonathan McVary. And by the way, Jonathan, thank you for holding my hand over the past 2 months, because I was a little bit nervous about this for understandable reasons. This is a tremendous honor, and I'm particularly humbled to share it with the other distinguished honorees, people we have the privilege to see every day, Dr. Fauci, Eugene Robinson, and Judy Woodruff. And as I said to Gene earlier, he's truly an overachiever, since I saw him on the air just a minute or two before I saw him in this room. Charlene, I'm looking forward to our discussion, and I do want to thank you for doing this, and I'm really pleased that we're paired together tonight. But first, I'd like to just say a few things about some of the people who have influenced my career. You just saw my three cohorts at Heyman Associates, Lisa Ryan, Marianne Raynon, and Jessamine Katz, who have been colleagues in business with me for over 30 years. And any success I've had is because of them. The success that Heyman Associates has had is due to our team and how well they manage me. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say, as you all probably know, or all of those that know me, Tricia Logan manages me the best. So thank you, Tricia. I also want to acknowledge my friends and mentors from Gettysburg College, who at that critical moment in my life showed more faith in me than I had in myself, and I love them for that. There's also two Penn State graduates that were pretty instrumental in my career. The first was Ken Frazier, the CEO of Merck, who gave our firm an opportunity early on and still stands out as one of the most thoughtful hiring executives with whom I've ever worked. And before Ken, there was Larry Foster, the namesake of this award. Larry gave me a shot to do a search when I was a very young recruiter. And what I remember about Larry was he was smart, kind, fair, and honorable. That experience made tonight even more special. I want to acknowledge two other professional organizations that I feel passionately about. One is the Planck Center for Leadership and Public Relations and its founders, the late Betsy Planck and Bruce Berger. And the second important organization was born out of the pandemic shutdown, led by Jane Randall and the Conversation family that includes Charlene and me. Our work has been a true labor of love. Most importantly, however, I want to recognize my wife, Doreen, and my daughters, Allison and Corey, who let me do what I do and make me strive to never take a day off from being the best version of myself. So tonight, I can't help but think about my parents. My late father was both a gentleman and a gentleman. I've always appreciated my dad's decency and humility and recognized the influence he has had on me. I really do hope he's watching tonight. And my mother, who is still with us at age 100, once said something that has proved to be the best advice I've ever got. She said that because I'm an only child, friends would be especially important in my life. And she was so right. And there are many friends who have joined tonight and those that are, many that are not here, but they sustain me and I appreciate them more than you can possibly say, more than I can possibly say. I really believe my mother's advice also prepared me for a career that revolves entirely around people. Heyman Associates doesn't produce content. We don't do media relations, we don't write speeches, and we don't stage events. We make matches. Mom's advice was to value relationships, cultivate friendships, and recognize the importance of character. And recognizing the importance of character, it also reflects on people's work. And I believe that goes to the heart of some of the most important issues in communications. And I touch upon that now. And at the risk of sounding a little bit pandering, but also sincere, I want to thank the Page Center for pairing me tonight with Charlene, whose leadership over the past year for the Page Society has been remarkable. And it's truly a perfect example of the right person for the moment. So I look forward to our discussion.
Great. Thank you.
When am I? I'm supposed to do something with this. Topher, I hope I did this at the right time.
So. We will forgive you if you didn't, because you're an honoree this evening. So how about a brief Q&A? So, Bill, I have to ask, you know, as a communications recruiter, you have one of the most unique perspectives on the people in the communications world. When you look for a candidate for, say, a chief communications officer job now, what are the essential characteristics that you look for?
So I think the most important thing that good communicators have to have is both self-confidence and self-awareness. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by confidence is being able to speak truth to power, to tell whoever the top person is, whether it's the CEO or the board, things that they might not want to hear. You know, to lead a company through a difficult crisis by painting a vision for the future that they might not be able to see. And I think that comes with having a level of confidence. I'm not talking about arrogance or boastfulness. I'm talking about confidence that leads to sort of self-awareness. Clients need to know that the people that they're working with have that level of confidence and can be truthful with them. It adds up to sort of a critical role that communications people play in helping to develop corporate character. And I believe communications is uniquely responsible, it has unique responsibility that cannot be discharged either internally inside a company or externally without a considerable amount of individual courage and confidence and a strong moral compass. It also helps to know what you don't know. And that's really where the self-awareness piece comes in, Charlene.
Great. So our next question, and which I think you've already answered, about when someone walks into your office for an interview, what do you notice first? What do you want to know about them in order to put them in front of a client?
I guess I want to know what they notice in my office. Obviously, we're doing Zooms now, so that's a different scenario. Try to get a sense of what matters to them. I want to know how they consume their news, what they read. What are their priorities? I'd like to know what they've learned from their failures. I'd like to hear who they give credit to for their successes. I'd like to know how well they listen essentially, we've always at Heyman Associates prided ourselves in trying to focus on these intangibles, because I think finding out what people have done in their careers is fine, but I think how they've arrived at those decisions is important. So.
Thank you. And of course, in these days, we can't have a Q&A and not ask a COVID question. And COVID, of course, is very close to companies and CCOs. So how has COVID changed, or the pandemic changed, the search process?
Well, if we had time, I'd fish through my cell phone and show you the picture of the one day I took the Long Island Railroad into New York in the last 11 months. So I have been doing nothing but Zoom meetings. Our organization works on every platform imaginable. So everything has been through the lens of this lens. Mm-hmm. And I think that what's happened is communications, I would argue, has been elevated in the midst of this, because one of the things that's happened is that there have been three particular points of inflection over the past year. I'll speak them quickly. One is the COVID and the fact that COVID-19 and the fact that everybody's working from home. The second one was the murder of George Floyd. And the third one was the insurrection at the Capitol. And in every one of those cases, I think CEOs do a great job at running businesses, but they didn't know how to handle these things. So it was really important for these communicators to be able to let them know how to handle those kinds of issues in the midst of what is a very difficult situation. I mean, sometimes they're just, the CEOs are purely innocent, but just a bit tone deaf about these. So I would argue that, you know, working on these kind of platforms, one thing that I found is kind of interesting is we do have more time and we do have more privacy. So there are things that you can almost have a little bit more of an insightful conversation. And it's important to be able to do this, because in a world where there is no in-person face-to-face meetings, we have to be able to accomplish it through these mediums. And I think we've been fairly successful.
Great. And, you know, just picking up on that, Bill, you know, more and more companies are undertaking social justice initiatives and feel pressure to take positions on issues they may have previously sought to avoid. How is this affecting what companies are looking for in their communications professionals?
I thought we were supposed to try to keep this to 10 minutes. We could go on forever. It's a really complex and important question. It's also difficult. And it's difficult because after decades of talking about diversity, we still haven't really done a very good job with it. I would argue that companies are looking for diversity in their workforce. They're not particularly good at it. And I think that I recently heard one of the president of a major trade association for business executives talk about the fact that it's been an area where they've failed. So I think that what I would argue is that it's our job as recruiters to start pushing our clients to widen the aperture as they start to look for people and not be so narrow. It's hard not to be. They're hiring recruiters to be very narrow in what we're looking for.
And I think we have one last question for Bill, which comes from Diana Martinelli.
You'll often get a client that will ask a candidate, what have you done in the area of diversity and inclusion? Mm-hmm. But the other time, what also will happen is that candidates want to know, what is this company doing itself? Why do I want to go to work here? Why is this a place? So I think these are two issues. They're not the only ones. And I still don't feel we've addressed it sufficiently. And it's an area that we need to keep working at.
All right. Well, we'll work it together, Bill.
Okay.
And one last question that's coming from Diana Martinelli, who is a professor at West Virginia University. And she's asking, how do you believe the events of the past year have changed communicators' ethical responsibilities?
Well, first of all, hello, Diana. She and I served on the board of the Planck Center together. I think that this has been a time for communications to be empowered to be that moral compass. I think that as a generalization, that people have to teach their organizations on all those issues that Diana mentioned, to listen from the other person's point of view, to understand where the pain points are for people. But and on balance, I would tell you that I think this has been it's been hard fought, and somewhat, I feel somewhat saddened by this, but it has been a gift from the communications gods that this stuff is done well to help create moral, better moral compasses for organizations which we work. So,
Bill, thank you for being here tonight and sharing your wise words. And thank you for all that you do and your commitment to integrity. Congratulations again on this prestigious award.
Thank you for having me. See you tomorrow night.